Let's consider how these images of body slices are generated from the data recorded by the scanner. The basic mathematics behind this problem was actually solved in general terms as long ago as 1917. In many ways, it's rather like trying to calculate the positions of all the trees in a forest from photographs taken through the forest in various different directions. Here's Dr. James Cubillo of Coventry University.
The tomographic imaging process begins, of course, with data acquisition. This is referred to as the forward projection. The data are in the form of attenuation profiles obtained at equal intervals as the instrument rotates about the body. I'll demonstrate that with a simple object. Here we have a square object with uniform high attenuation. This is the imaging plane. If we irradiate the object with a parallel beam of X-rays from the left here, you can see that we obtain an attenuation profile here. Outside of the object area, we have zero attenuation. Where we have the object, we have uniform high attenuation level. As we rotate the instrument through some angle, you can see that we still have zero attenuation outside of the object here, uniform attenuation here between these two points where we have equal path lengths. Between these two points, the path length is gradually increasing, and we see that we have an attenuation profile which also increases uniformly. At 45 degrees, you can see that we have maximum attenuation here, corresponding to the diagonal of the square, which of course is maximum for this object. Between these two points, we have uniformly increasing attenuation as the path length increases. And the process continues as we rotate the instrument relative to the object.
In these forward projections, James has actually rotated the object and fixed the direction of the beam to make it easier to compare one attenuation profile with the next. However, in an actual scan and in the reconstructions to come, it's the instrument that rotates and not the object.
Now let's look at a slightly more complicated scene in which we have two squares, each of high uniform attenuation. We irradiate the scene as before, and you can see that we have rectangular attenuation profiles here for each of the squares. Rotating the beam through 45 degrees, we have two triangular profiles corresponding to each of these two squares. Then at 90 degrees, we're back to the rectangular profiles. However, at 135 degrees, the two squares are in line, and therefore we have maximum attenuation corresponding to the maximum path length of these two squares in line.
These attenuation profiles and knowledge of the direction of each forward projection are all that's required to reconstruct the original object. This process is known as simple back projection.
Here we have the original object. This scale here is known as the hot body scale, with white and yellow representing high attenuation and red and black representing low attenuation. Applying a back projection at 0 degrees, we have an equal likelihood of the objects occurring anywhere along these paths. Now if we apply a back projection at 90 degrees, we can see that, surprisingly enough, we have four candidate positions for these squares, leaving us with an ambiguous situation. It is only when we add the 45 degree projection that we confirm the positions of the two squares. Going on further to 135 degree projection, again the position is reinforced once more.
This ambiguity would not have existed with the single square, and this illustrates a general point. The more complex the images are, the more projections are required to avoid ambiguity in the reconstructed image.
Now, if we go on further to reconstructing the whole image, starting with 0 degree projection and building up at 15 degree intervals, we can see the two squares forming with each projection. And now, with the completed image with 24 back projections, we can see clearly the two squares that we started with. However, they do appear slightly blurred.
Convolution of the object with the point spread function leads to a blurring effect, as you can see more clearly in this three-dimensional mesh plot of the same data. This problem is inherent to the back projection process and cannot be avoided, even by taking extra projections. But as you can see, a simple object, consisting of two squares, can still be reconstructed reasonably well. However, when simple back projection is applied to real CT data, the blurring effect seems to be much more serious. There are two reasons for this. Firstly, the objects imaged in a real CT scan have a whole range of density values, whereas the squares in James's model have just one. And secondly, a much higher spatial resolution is required. Nevertheless, the technique can be improved by filtering the data before carrying out the reconstruction. And this is known as filtered back projection.
Here is an infinite ramp filter that can be applied to the reconstruction. Along the horizontal axis, you can see the spatial frequency. And on the vertical axis, we can see the relative amplitude of the signal passed by the filter. You can see that the filter itself discriminates against low frequencies in favour of the high frequencies. However, with such a filter, we will run into aliasing problems. And so we need to apply the Nyquist criteria to cut off the filter at half the maximum spatial sampling frequency, as we have here. Now let's see what we get when we apply this filter to the back projections we saw earlier. Here we have the two original objects, and here is the filtered back projection. As you can see, we get a much clearer, sharper image. Although it is still not perfect, much of the blurring has been removed. And here is the mesh plot. There's obviously a vast improvement over the simple back projection. And here we have a comparison of the simple back projection compared with the filtered back projection with their respective mesh plots. And the improvement is clear to see.
Okay, so filtering the data greatly improves the reconstruction of this simple model. But how well does it perform on the pelvic slice we saw earlier? Well, as you can see, we now have a clear, sharp image in which we can identify the top of the femur, the bladder, and the spinal cord, a vast improvement over the blurred image we obtained with simple back projection. Filtered back projection is the method of reconstruction used in modern CT imaging. The only difference from the process you've just seen is that the filters are rather more sophisticated than the cut-off ramp filter James used.